Hello and welcome to another episode of the CG Garage. This is episode number 340 featuring Bernie Frischer, digital archaeologist and founder and president of Flyover Zone Productions. This is a fascinating podcast with a really cool guy talking about archaeology. Kristen, what did you think about this?
There was so much in this. One, he's a language master. I couldn't believe all the stuff he knows. And he writes about virtual heritage, classics, and the survival of the classical world. And his career kind of stemmed from his interest in classical language and the movie business, which his family owned a bunch of cinemas, which is cool. And then archaeology was kind of his way to integrate all his interests. He's right now, you guys talked about this, I'm not going to say it correctly, but he's reconstructing Rome virtually, and you talked about it being like a metaverse, and you got into that. And then what Flyover Zone is, his company, I like the little pun he said it was, or not pun, it's the famous Flyover Zone in the U.S. And they use 3D digital technologies to recreate important cultural monuments around the world for the public, and just to keep love of the cultural heritage alive among young people and to help scholars. And as he said, you can see old things in a new way. So it was just a multitude of things he talked about and is super interesting.
Yeah, he's a fascinating person for sure. I mean, they're basically, you know, as he like you said, he's an archaeologist, and he's got a passion for recreating digital versions of old cities like Rome, for example, in digitally. And he's recreated Rome multiple times due to as the technology gets better and better, he's able to get more details or whatever he's doing. And we talk about that at length. And he's actually been using Chaos Cloud quite a bit recently. So that's how we got to know Bernie. But he's a really fascinating person and talking about the digital world and archaeology. I actually have an interest in archaeology myself, having lived in both Cairo and Athens as a child. So we talk a little bit about that. It was fascinating talking to him and finding out all of the cool things that he's done. He knows a lot of people that I know as well. I mean, he helped as well with Paul Debevic on the Parthenon project way back when. So really fascinating person. Great to have Bernie on to discuss all these amazing things. And yes, he is definitely a language expert, as you said. All right. We've got a couple of announcements. Kristen, what's going on?
Yeah, so you can find this one out at chaos.com/events. This is our big one we've been talking about the last few weeks, but it's 24 Hours of Chaos. We did it last year for the first time. It's going to be September 9th and 10th. It's 12 back-to-back shows with more than 60 hosts, speakers, and guests, all in a 24-hour live stream. And you can find out more about this at chaos.com/24hours. Hours spelled out.
Yep.
H-O-U-R-S.
That's correct. And so that's correct. Yes, this is our second edition of the 24 Hours of Chaos. It was a blast last year, and I can't wait to do it again this year. We will be covering the West Coast zone of the stream, which will be a lot of fun. Please join us. That's again September 9th and 10th. It'll be all of that information is available at chaos.com/24hours, the number 24 and then hours spelt out. We have a couple of product announcements, or at least one big product announcement. What can you tell us, Kristen?
Yes. V-Ray 5 for Unreal is available now.
Yes, that is correct. I am very excited because I have been doing a lot of work actually with V-Ray 5 or V-Ray for Unreal. It's really cool. So now V-Ray 5 is available there, which is a pretty nice update. And there's some really great things that have been added to V-Ray 5 for Unreal. So go check it out at chaos.com. Now, if people want to know more about the podcast, where can they go?
You can go to facebook.com/CG Garage Podcast or chaos.com/CG Garage. And if you'd like to watch us, go to youtube.com/chaosgroupTV.
Perfect. And if you guys have ideas of other podcasts or have questions about this podcast or have some suggestions of any kind, please let us know. Our email is labs@chaosgroup.com, and can't wait to hear from you. We've gotten some great suggestions in the past, and we really would love to hear your suggestions if you have them. And if you have, of course, if you want to rate us, please rate us on Apple Podcasts and leave us a review and a rating there and share us with all of your friends and family. But for now, please enjoy episode 340 featuring Bernie Frischer, digital archaeologist, founder and president of Flyover Zone Productions.
Welcome to another CG Garage, where the chaos group talks. You'll know it's over when the last bucket drops. We're gonna fire off rays in high dynamic range. We know that ambient occlusion is passé. Global illumination won't lead you astray. And while image-based lighting is really swell, you need to make sure everything has Fernell.
I have a little bit of a soft spot for archaeology. I don't know if, well, you probably don't know this, but I was actually, as an American, I was actually born in Cairo. And I lived in Cairo when I was very young. And then after that, we moved to Athens. So I spent a lot of time in both Egyptian archaeology and ancient Greek archaeology. So I do have, and we have a lot of archaeology friends, as you can imagine. So I'm very curious about this. I'd love to hear your thoughts a little bit about how you got into archaeology and then how you got into computer graphics and how you ended up marrying these two things together. So a little bit about your past would be fascinating.
Great. Well, thanks for inviting me to talk. I appreciate it very much. So to explain how I got to where I am now at age 72 as a digital archaeologist, we have to go back to my youth, where I always had the virtue of interdisciplinary studies was instilled into me, even in junior high and high school. I went to a very innovative public school in Beechwood, Ohio, a suburb of Cleveland on the east side. And that school system was proud of a interdisciplinary humanities program that it developed, so that at the same time you would be studying, say, world history, you would also study world literature, and to whatever extent possible, other arts and sciences were synchronized with your advance through historical periods from antiquity and then eventually by senior year down to the modern world. So an interdisciplinary approach to things was instilled in me at a young age. And when I got to college, of course, like everybody else, I had to have a major. And my major was classical studies, which primarily was Greek and Latin. But I always wanted to go to Rome and Athens and elsewhere in the classical world. But first I had to get my PhD, which I did in Heidelberg, again in Greek and Latin language, literature, philosophy, that sort of thing. And then I was fortunate enough to win a postdoc, a thing called the Prix de Rome, the Rome Prize, in classical studies at the American Academy in Rome. And back then, the fellowship lasted for 2 years, and you had to propose, you know, whatever it was you're going to do. And I proposed adding archaeology to my toolkit, my intellectual toolkit. And I did that. I was fortunate enough to win the fellowship. I went there, and the great American Roman archaeologist Frank Brown was getting toward the end of his career, was still active, and took me on and mentored me. And I was able to draw on some of my technical background, my hobbies. As a teenager, I had a third-class radio license, so I got into electronics. I had a dark room, so I was very involved with photography. And I wanted to be a filmmaker, actually, when I was growing up. My family owned cinemas, and my uncle was Chief Barker of the Variety Club tent in Cleveland for many years. So we're very involved in the movie business. Anyway, archaeology was a way to integrate all of these sort of interests I found. And so then when I got my first teaching job, which was at UCLA way back in 1976, I was half-time in classical studies teaching like golden Latin poets and Greek tragedians, and half-time in classical archaeology. So that, in a nutshell, is how I got involved. The archaeology came to have preponderant weight in my, you know, thinking and publications over the years, and the classical part kind of receded, although I still love classical literature and classical authors.
Interesting. Interesting. I think the classics are very, you know, I took Latin in school. It was tough for me, actually, because I was, I'm dyslexic as well. So Latin and dyslexia do not go so well together sometimes. but it was definitely very interesting for sure. So you didn't really sort of get into archaeology. That sort of was like almost like a, but it makes sense, I guess, to have classical languages and archaeology, I mean, it must definitely help your archaeology knowing all of those things about the language, especially at that time, right?
Absolutely. And another thing that helps is modern languages, because so much of the archaeological literature is in German, French, Italian, and then, of course, the language of whatever country it is you're working in. So right. I'm also a great believer in study abroad. I was head of study abroad at UCLA in the 1990s, and I myself went to Germany, to Tübingen, my junior year, and I did my PhD in Heidelberg. So right. I'm fluent in German, and then when I went to Rome, first thing I did was get a tutor to learn Italian, and I'm also fluent in Italian. And I've studied other right. languages, including, you know, Middle Egyptian and Hebrew and Turkish and so on. At least I have a smattering
that's pretty
of those
amazing.
Languages.
Yeah, yeah. That's really amazing. And I just find that fascinating, and sort of studying those things were great. What was your interest in Rome? I mean, I noticed you have a big interest in Rome, obviously. Mm-hmm. What drew you to the Roman culture and the intrigue and that mystery that was going on there?
Here I have to admit to kind of a character defect. Actually, when I was in college and high school, I was much more attracted to Greek literature, Greek culture. And okay. in college, I probably took two Greek courses for every one Latin course that I took. In fact, I had 5 years of Latin in high school, and I promised myself when I left high school, I would never study Latin again because I found it so boring, really. I was good at it. I got a 5 on the AP Latin exam. But here's how nerdy I was. I refused to go to my high school graduation unless my parents sent me to the intensive Greek program at the University of Michigan. I wanted to hit college with 1 year of college Greek under my belt, which I did. And I still love Greek much more, philosophy, the tragedians. My first publication was on the tragedian Euripides, published when I was 19 years old. And then what happened? Well, then I visited Athens and I visited Rome. And this is where the defect in my character comes in. I mean, the cuisine, the people, the cultural richness, the 3,000 years of uninterrupted, you know, culture of Rome just dwarfed Athens. I still love Athens. But to me, it, you know, it's like Greek cuisine versus Italian cuisine. Greek cuisine is kind of a one-liner. It's, you know, Greek salad and lamb. And
yep.
It's great. I love it. But, you know, after a week, you get tired of it. It's repetitive. Italian cuisine, with all the regions and the varieties of pastas and sauces and second courses and desserts, I mean, it's infinite. It's one of the really... So that's my defect as a person, is that I gave in to the charm of Italian culture. I really fell in love with Italy. And I thought, all right, well, if I'm going to be in Italy, I better concentrate more on the Romans than on the Greeks. Never right. forgetting the Greeks, of course. We can't forget the Greeks. The Romans,
we can't forget the Greeks. They're great, great philosophers.
The
yeah. Yes, yeah. Indeed. I lived in Greece for 11 years, so I'm very familiar with what you're talking about. But yes, but I do. There's a lot of things that are to love about Greece as well, especially the islands. The islands are fantastic.
Sure. And I love Greece. And I don't mean to be demeaning to Greece, but if you have a choice for what you're going to spend your life on,
I get
on,
it when you
all.
Say about the food. The Greek food is very good, but you're right. You know, you go to a taverna, it's pretty much, there's no menu. It's all the same thing.
Yeah, and I love it, but, you know, it doesn't compare to Italian. I think
I get it.
A reasonable Greek would be the first to admit that.
Absolutely, absolutely. Okay, now, so what? Around what time are we looking at? So now you've got your interest in archaeology. At what point did computer graphics start to come into play here, and your idea of reconstructing history in some way?
Yes. Well, you know, my generation was a generation of the '60s, and we wanted to be rebels. We thought our revolution would be a political revolution. It turned out to be the computer revolution. And you know, when I hear the people today making fun of or making disparaging remarks about the boomers, which I was born in 1949, so I'm right in the middle of the boomer generation. Well, we gave you the computer revolution. That's our major contribution. So how did I get involved in that? Well, I started in physics in college. We had to learn computer programming, write a program, something very simple, which I did. That put computing into my mental map. And then when in the 1970s, I had a lot of friends that at UCLA, obviously, once I got there in the sciences, and one of them was a very close friend, a chemist, who got her first personal computer in 1980, and I said to her, should I get one of those? And started investigating it. By 1981, I got my first personal computer and got involved in the personal computer club of UCLA, and I became head of humanities computing in, 1987, 88, right before I went to Italy to run the study abroad programs of the University of California in Italy for a couple of years. And so that got me hooked on computing. I got a grant from the Getty Trust to put all of the digital texts of Greek and Latin together onto a server and put it on the internet, which was very new then. It was really only available with a Defense Department contract, and make it available at the Getty Research Center and at UCLA in my department. We did that. I think I can claim to have been the first to put the Greek and Latin authors onto the internet. And then, of course, as somebody who's doing 50% of his career, spending 50% of his career in archaeology, I wanted to also apply computing to that. So as early as 1974, I had this vision of digitizing a great physical model of ancient Rome. And I studied different technical ways of doing that, starting with video and video disc. And by 1989-90, I could see that just digitizing that physical model wouldn't cut it, because it was lacking in detail, architectural detail, to warrant a close look. It was made to be seen from a balcony. It's at a scale of 1 to 250. Blow it up 1 to 1, and you got a lot of kind of blank white plaster walls of all those little models. So I needed to get into CAD. Luckily, UCLA, a school of architecture, where I had a very dear friend, famous architect who died of AIDS, unfortunately, in 1996. But he introduced me to the CAD group, computer-aided design, that was, and UCLA was one of the centers for where CAD was developed. And Bill Mitchell was the professor who was driving that, became the head of architecture at MIT and oversaw the Media Lab, the famous Media Lab. Yeah. And he was a friend. So I became aware of this, and there was a thing called the Urban Simulation Lab in the School of Architecture, which was dedicated to making 3D models, first of downtown LA and then eventually the whole LA basin. I took the course in 3D modeling. So now we're like 1994, 95. I got a grant from a local foundation, started on Rome Reborn, the digital recreation of ancient Rome in the same period. That's why I was studying this. So that's how that came about. I was just fortunate to be at a place where CAD was very strong, and I knew the right people and got involved that way.
That is a very important part in time in the digital world. I mean, I went to architecture school, believe it or not, in 93 at Rice University in Houston.
That's a great school.
We were just studying all the stuff that was going on digitally. I gravitated towards the computer graphic area. People were like, well, you know, I guess I got to learn CAD. I was like, no, I want to go all the way with computer graphics. And I sort of definitely knew what Mitchell was doing and all the stuff and the model of the LA Basin, very aware of that. So you were right in the thick of it at that time.
Yeah.
That must have been a very exciting time.
It was. And, you know, we had the attention of the trustees of the Getty Trust, and they were sponsoring some early virtual reality. The first time I became aware of virtual reality was about 1991, too, when a company in Rome called Infobyte was hired by the Getty Trust to make a virtual reality experience of the tomb of Nefertari. And that caused quite a stir in LA. And then I was hired by the Getty Trust to collaborate on the opening of the Brentwood Center, the Getty Brentwood Center, and in particular the gallery where the department, the unit of education at the Getty and the antiquities department of the Getty Museum were going to collaborate on a virtual reality project. And they decided, with my advice, to work on Trajan's Forum. So we made a virtual reconstruction of Trajan's Forum using that urban simulation group as our lab. And I was very fortunate to be in the right place at the right time. And then to have patronage in the foundations that supported me, philanthropists in the LA area that got it and helped out with money, which was very important at that time, because nowadays, where you've got every city and university around the world wants to be the center of gaming, and they see, you know, dollar signs or euro signs or whatever their currency is when you say gaming, they want to build the local economy around that. The skills are ubiquitous, and you can get skillful 3D modelers for very little. But back then, when it was all very new, and we were competing against Hollywood studios, I remember going to visit the Warner Brothers digital studio, very advanced place. They were sucking up all the talent pool, which was very small back then, and we had to pay a lot of money to hire competent people and the equipment. We were all stuck on the SGI, the Silicon Graphics platform, where the computers yep. were, you know, millions of dollars, and the software was tens of thousands of dollars a seat. So it was all yep. very expensive. So without that financial support and the vision of these philanthropists, we couldn't have gotten anywhere either.
Yeah, at that time it was, like you said, it was very expensive. I used to estimate pretty much it would be about $250,000 per seat that you had to, you know, including yeah. the hardware, the salary, the software. It was all extremely yeah. expensive back then.
It was really expensive.
Yeah. So that's really interesting that you were sort of, you know, really trying to push the envelope in archaeology at the same time that the movie industry had just really started to get into it in the movie industry as well. So you were competing against the people that were in the movie industry while secretly inside you wanted to be a filmmaker at some time point, right?
That's right. And we had a visionary vice chancellor for research, Kumar Patel, who was one of the developers of the laser in his student days at Stanford. And then mm-hmm. rose to be head of Bell Labs. And then he came to UCLA as the vice chancellor for research. And he brought a whole new model of funding research to UCLA, which I won't go into. But he introduced me. He had a council of advisors that included a lot of people in the movie industry. And he thought that what we were doing could be of use to the movie industry. So we were competing in a way, yeah, on a low level for staff.
For talent.
But on a higher mm-hmm. level, he was thinking there could be collaboration and set up some meetings with me and studio executives. But they all probably rightly thought that this was, the idea that, for example, for Gladiator, the film would benefit from having our very accurate 3D model of the Colosseum as opposed to the one their art director came up with, was not necessary. I did make the point that, okay, maybe historical accuracy isn't important because your audience will never know that things are wrong. And they were wildly wrong with the Colosseum in that movie, which I love. But what if it's cheaper and quicker just to do it right? I mean, we've already done it, so why not license it from us rather than starting right. from scratch? But anyway, I got no traction with them. We were hoping that we could, but we didn't.
That they don't always, the movie industry doesn't always go with accuracy sometimes. Like, a velociraptor is actually the size of a turkey, and it's much smaller than they have it in Jurassic Park. So,
and I understand it. And I taught a course yeah. on Hollywood in the ancient world, and going through these classic Roman movies. And I thought that the advantage was that, first of all, it got kids interested. They became aware of Julius Caesar, Alexander the Great, et cetera, through a movie in a much more immediate way than by reading about a historical figure like that. Secondly, the mistakes were great because that's exactly what I assigned to the students. Read the historical sources to figure out what we know happened and then compare it to the movie version and write a paper of compare and contrast and figure out what the artistic reason for the departures. I mean, there's nothing, these are works of fiction, so they have poetic right. license. I'm all for that. So establish the relationship of truth and fiction and then try to figure out the artistic reason for those departures from the truth. Because again, why not just tell the story the way of the assassination of Julius Caesar, the way Plutarch does? Why make it up? That complicates things. You have to think. Why not just stick right. to what actually happened?
Yeah, absolutely. That sounds fascinating. Now, it obviously makes sense, the computer graphics and CAD make sense when it comes to architecture, but reconstructing historic things on the computer to preserve them in a digital fashion also seems to make a lot of sense. Besides the idea of preservation, what was the other motivations that you felt were important in digitizing archaeology in that way?
Well, the field of Roman topography, so the history of the city of Rome, when I came along, was completely disorganized. I mean, I remember a professor of the subject from University of Illinois gave me a tour of the Library of the American Academy of Rome, a great research library, to point out just what are the classic reference works available for studying the city of Rome in antiquity. And we were popping around the library. There was no synthetic work, and was really just a mess. So luckily I was there for 2 years. I devoted myself nonstop to the study of ancient Rome. I had a great mentor, Frank Brown, who'd been there since the early 1930s and poured out his heart and soul into walks and talks with the fellows to orient us to the ruins and the way the city really was. And then we had that physical model. And that physical model was really important that I referred to earlier of the built over a 40-year period by Italo Gismondi and some model makers and displayed in a museum in Rome, the Museum of Roman Civilization. And so this all gave me the idea that, look, the easiest way to integrate all this knowledge is through a model. Well, we have the physical model, but the physical model doesn't talk and you can't mark it up. It's not interactive. The good thing about digital technology is you could click on a building, say, what is this? And open up a window and get some basic information, get some links. So do a hypermedia approach where you can bring in the different disparate resources, right? All together with the visualization that they refer to. So that was the idea, that the educational use. That, and I really believe that, for example, our company has tours of ancient Rome, and now we're doing Greece and Egypt and Tenochtitlan, ancient Mexico City. And I really believe that, you know, since these are put together by experts, they reflect the reconstructions developed by experts, and then the same experts turn around and write the scripts or are interviewed in our presentations, in our guided tours, that after 3 hours in our Roman Forum, for example, the average intelligent person will know as much or more than a PhD in the subject, a young PhD in the subject. Because it's like, you know, who will know more about the symphonies of Beethoven? Somebody who's an intelligent listener and understands music, but listens to, say, the Herbert von Karajan recordings of the nine symphonies, or somebody who comes to Beethoven for the first time and only has the musical scores and sort of laboriously goes through them. I'm not saying that that can't be a good and valid approach too, but it'll obviously take a lot longer than just sitting back and listening for whatever it would be, 9 to 12 hours to all the symphonies.
Yes, it's true, but there's also I think there's something visual about it that allows you to learn. You're able to remember things much better with a visual reference.
Yes, right? Absolutely. And to see and things and to have insights and to have new ideas even, to go beyond what we already know. And that is on the research side. So I think the main thrust of what we're doing is it was always from start educational, but it also involved what I call sympiricism or empirical studies supported by computer simulations. And the problem with the study of the past is it's never been empirical because we can never go back in time to run experiments or make observations. But once we have these models that are as accurate as we can make them, it's as if we have a model of a galaxy, and then we want to see, how far is it, how fast is it receding from our galaxy, or how, you know, what's its relationship to the other galaxies in its local area? Well, you can't do that by observation because these things play out over many, many years, millions of years, way beyond one lifetime. And you can't go there and make the observations close up because they're also so far away. So you make, in astronomy, you work with computer simulations. Almost exclusively now.
Yeah, but
okay, and the same thing with historical problems. We can't go back in time, but we can recreate the past and run experiments and recreate experiences.
I think the analogy to the to galaxies is obviously a lot of is very good because there's obviously there's some interpretation that goes on in both. There has to be because there's missing data that you have to fill in, right?
Yes, so, absolutely.
So I know this is obviously a fundamental part of archaeology, but what is the process of filling in the missing information that when you see obviously a lot of these historical places are in ruins and you have to interpret of like, okay, this is what it probably looked like. So how do you fill that in? What is the process of that?
Well, remember, I always like to, when people bring this up, I always like to refer to the inscription Plato put over the entrance to the academy in ancient Athens. Only those who know geometry may enter. And what I say for archaeology is only those who can tolerate uncertainty may enter. If you don't like uncertainty, go into some other branch of study, like, 20th century history, where your problem is the opposite. You've got too many documents, too much information to boil down and get on top of. With anything archaeological, you're always going to encounter the problem of uncertainty. So, of course, archaeologists have developed best practices for how to deal with uncertainty. And in this particular field, we have the London Charter and then the Seville Principles of Virtual Archaeology that have developed. And I was a supporter of these two initiatives. The earlier one, the London Charter, actually builds on an article that I published with a number of other people in the 1990s about this. And the best practice is, first of all, you have to be totally honest and open, first with yourself to start out with, but then eventually with your audience, whether it's a professional audience or the general public. We're not pulling the wool over anyone's eyes here about what is definitely known and what we had to make up to fill the gaps. Secondly, in making it up, you have to flag that hypothetical part of the restoration. And you do that in one of three ways, either visually. For example, you could leave the hypothetical parts of your scene in wireframe format and not make them solid and textured and photorealistic, but just leave them in wireframe. That's already a visual clue that, hey, there's something a little bit sketchy or going on. Or you could do it textually. You could just write, you know, in the level of metadata, you can say, you know, in this scene, we for sure know the foundations and we know the first order, but anything above that, that superstructure has been supplemented. And then you have to give the reason or the method, usually on the basis of analogy. Okay, we don't have this particular apartment building, but we know enough about it and we know that there were only a certain limited number of types of Roman apartment buildings. We know what type it was, so we can guess what it must have looked like. You give the reason. And then the third approach is a hybrid where you could have a visual clue and obviously the textual explanation going along with it. And so in effect, I always like to say this is in the Gutenbergian medium of scholarly writing, it's like having footnotes. The obligation that you have as a scholar is not just to give your conclusions and your opinions, but to flag any disagreement, any alternative views. And at a minimum, you would do that in a footnote where you would cite the alternative view and ideally say a few words about why you think your view is better than the alternative view. So these are, in effect, our footnotes. And this is a very big thing that we had to work out in the 1990s. How are we going to tame, you know, I actually talked about it this week, tame this new medium for scholarly use, for scientific use?
Right.
And it had been developed for artistic use, which is great. But we're going to tame it as scholars and do the same kind of things like footnotes and bibliography I'm going to move this a little bit farther away because I think I'm getting some pop. But that we would do in writing, we had to figure out how to do the same analogous kinds of moves, intellectual moves in this visual medium.
Yeah, absolutely. I think it's a very interesting thing. You know, I think the visual medium is really fascinating. In one of the people who influenced my passion in computer graphics, really actually lied in lighting, believe it or not. And people who influenced a lot of my the things that I do and inspired me a lot of ways is actually Paul Debevic, who's now a good friend of mine.
Yeah.
Yes. And Paul was really some of his first big projects that he got a lot of notoriety were specifically about archaeology and about things like that. In fact, I think I helped him a little bit with the Parthenon project, which was incredible.
I helped him with the Parthenon project too. Just at initially the level of introducing him to some of the people who knew a lot about the Parthenon. Yes,
right.
And that's a great project.
It is a great project, and it really sort of taught me a little bit about how far you can get into details and how far you can try to preserve the truth, right? Like, it's like, this is how far Paul could get. And it's like, based on the information I got, this is how much I could get out of it. And it was really a fascinating project, and I thought it was really well done. And it certainly revived my interest in archaeology and in that medium. But how, you know, obviously from early 1990s to today, computer graphics has changed quite a bit. And so how have those changes affected what you're able to do and what you're able to see and what you're able to use this material for? Can you tell me a little bit about how that evolution has helped you guys?
Yes, I always say that I obviously did something wrong in a previous life, and I'm being made to pay for it by having to rebuild the city of ancient Rome, which is 7,000 buildings in about 25 square kilometers. Not once, not twice, not three times, but we're on the fourth time. largely because of the changes in computer graphics, where we can do more and more, and it looks better and better, and we can go from only being able to realistically for our end user provide still images to realistically provide 1080p video, to now being able to finally do what we set out to do way back when I first proposed doing this in 1986 at a private conference at Apple, which was my paper was published in 88, real-time free roaming around the scene in the company of avatars who represent, the cultural knowledge, the people of ancient Rome or ancient Greece, and explain to you what you're seeing, and or you can observe them going about their everyday activities and figure out for yourself what it is that they were up to. So finally, we're able to do that. We finally have the ability. I've got some great staff in my company. Luckily, we continued to attract support. I mean, obviously, it had ups and downs. The 2008 recession didn't help at all, set us back for a few years. But in recent years, we've had some very generous support again, investing in the company. And we've been able to put together a crack team of CG specialists of all kinds, who range as far afield as Georgia and Alexandria, the country of Georgia, Tbilisi, and Alexandria in Egypt. But also locally here in Indiana, we have some wonderful graduates of my university, Indiana University, because my other hat that I wear is a professor of informatics, archaeoinformatics, to be precise.
Oh, okay.
I teach virtual heritage, we call it.
Virtual heritage.
So, I don't know if that was too vague, but in those in broad strokes, our project primarily Rome Reborn. We said Rome was our laboratory. Once we figured out how to do ancient Rome, we could do anything. So now we're moving into Athens, as I said, in Egypt and Mexico, and eventually we'd like to cover the four corners of the earth. All these changes were driven by improvements in the hardware and software that allowed us to do more and more and get a better visual quality at the same time. So it was a great twofer. Usually, right. those were trade-offs. Like,
obviously, speed of hardware is a big factor. But in terms of what it was enabling you guys to do, I mean, what else? What were some of the other things that were happening? I think you obviously mentioned VR was a part of your initiative at least at one point, and maybe later as well. So how did those different technologies change the way that you were looking at things in some ways?
Well, I started out really hoping to do a VR presentation of these ancient sites, and UCLA Architecture School was very had a very close working relationship with SGI, and had SGI equipment, and we had a so-called visualization lab. We had the 3D screen that was curved in two dimensions and had the active stereo glasses. I forget what SGI called that screen, but we had that at UCLA. It cost a huge amount of money, and that was available for our group to use. So that's where we started, was immersive virtual reality. But then, since we could only output our work on that platform, and most colleges and universities, let alone high schools and the general public, didn't have that equipment and had no access to it, we thought, all right, well, let's be realistic here, and let's output for just a standard Mac or PC. And that means we're going to have to settle with, as I said, 2D views, maybe panos. We can generate panoramas. We had some NSF funding to do that, to output our real-time model as a series of panos around the Roman Forum. Did that project in 2002 to 5. And then video. Okay, we can render out frames of video at different resolutions, which has always gotten, we started out at SD and then got to 720 and then 1080 and then 4K and 8K. But we always wanted to circle back and do the real-time version with free roaming, not necessarily for a totally immersive monitor headset or cave or whatever the various platforms might be for virtual reality, but even at the level of a smartphone. But just allow people to move around in real time, which is requires a lot of computing power and requires a lot of cleverness in the way your developers put the virtual world together, especially if it's a big thing like a city, as you know. So that's the way in which the changes of technology have impacted us. But I think we've reached a kind of a golden age here where the cost of doing this and the knowledge of how to do it across all these different platforms has reached a point where it's now possible to implement the original vision of the mid-1980s.
Right, right, which is interesting. I think, obviously, you know, real-time technology has changed quite a bit just recently. And I think that's obviously highly driven by the game world that is now, the game world is trying to enter the rest of the world at the same time, right?
So yes.
Those tools are, go ahead, yeah.
Yeah, and like our development team here locally, the graduates of Indiana University are coming out of computer science and our game program, and so that there's a lot of talent also that's been gifted to us by the game industry, and right. Not everybody who graduates from the game industry can get a job in the game industry.
Right. Well, you could always develop, you know, Grand Theft Chariot in Rome and make it a.
Yes.
An official, make a little bit of both. It's like, yes, you're playing a game, but you're going to learn about ancient Rome at the same time.
Yes. Well, and indeed, we do want to circle back and work on an app that's almost finished, which is called the Historical Games of Ancient Rome. It's not going to be called that. It's going to be called Spectacles of Ancient Rome. It's going to be chariot racing, the gladiatorial combats, the animal hunts, and mock sea battles. And we're pretty close to finishing that. And if any viewer out here is connected with a major game company, we've got it all mocked up, and it's functional. We know the rules and everything. But where what's given us pause is we have a limited amount of development money, and to really create a Class A game is extremely expensive. So we've got the bare bones of how it should work, what the rules are, and what the logic is, but to really make it competitive on a world market would require a big investment. So we're not in a position to make that investment. If anybody wants to team up with us, I'd love to hear from you.
Yeah, that would be really, really great. I mean, I know a couple of people in the gaming industry that could very well be interested. I will try to reach out to them myself if you want.
Because we've worked on it for 2 years and we've done the hard part, which is just figuring out what were these games and what were the rules and how many competitors did they have and what did they wear and where did they go and what did they do? And we have it all mocked up, but it just doesn't look good enough to attract the average teenager out there who plays games.
Right. So that is interesting, but I think that you do bring up a good point. It's like, it's always tricky, you know, as a father of teenagers, it is always tricky to try to get them to get interested in things that is sneaky in trying to educate them at the same time.
Yes, but, and this will do it. This Roman Spectacles will definitely do that. You'll learn a lot about ancient Rome this way, not only about the particular game, but about the, you know, who are the spectators and the money, and where do these animals come from? Well, the empire. What's the Roman Empire? I mean, it's on and on. The chariot race, all in honor of the sun god. Well, what do we know about Roman religion? What does chariot racing have to do with the sun god? Well, the sun was thought to be a god in a chariot going across the sky. So right at the finish line, there's a temple of the sun god, and the winner is considered to be the person most favored by the sun god, the embodiment of the sun god, if you will. And they have right at the finishing line, therefore, an obelisk from Egypt. Why an obelisk? Because to the Egyptians and the Romans knew this, an obelisk symbolizes a sunbeam. So, of course, this is all solar religion. So there's an obelisk, there's a temple of the sun, and the winner is the embodiment of the sun god. So, you know, you can learn a lot of tangential things that take you off in all kinds of directions.
That is excellent information. First of all, I didn't know all of that, which is great. And second, that is definitely game material. Materials, you're absolutely right. Like games will embody like, well, why did this happen? Why did that happen? Why did that happen? And you have to sort of, that process of learning this information to get to the next step actually is fantastic information. Yeah, I can definitely see that happening, Bernie. That would be an amazing game to play, actually.
Or the chariot races, the teams, the reds, the whites, the greens, the blues, and the way in which, we have people who are fans of the Yankees or the Dodgers or this or that team. But in Rome, the population was divided between the fans of these different circus factions, as they were called, the circus teams, which all had their colors. And the colors are expressed in the uniforms of the jockeys and the decorative elements that the horses wear and etc. And then you can get into the political figures who invested in these games, like Trajan, who built the final version of the Circus Maximus that we think could seat somewhere between 250 and 350,000 spectators. Big place.
Wow.
It is a very big place. I believe the Astrodome only held 80,000 people, and that was a big stadium.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, that's really fascinating. And actually, it's interesting. Obviously, Rome is very famous for its games. So it would make sense to have more games available at that in that area. Were you actually, were you interested in video games at all during that whole process? What you were doing things or?
Very little. I know very little about video games. Star Trek was included with my K-Pro, my first computer. And I went through a phase of being obsessed with that. And My stepdaughter, when she was a teenager, was given the original Pac-Man, and I remember scoffing at that, but then we were on sabbatical in Rome, and I saw it lying around in the apartment, and I went off and hid myself in a bathroom with it. And I remember my wife and stepdaughter going around the apartment saying, "Where are you, Bernie? Where are you?" And I was too embarrassed to say that I was holed up in the bathroom playing Pac-Man, but I became quite addicted to it. But I didn't keep up with it, and I sort of regret that. But on the other hand, I have a very long list of publications, and I've been at many universities, taught many different subjects. So I have the feeling that the price I would have paid would have been in my scholarly productivity.
Well,
my young people who work for me know all about video games. So
Well, that's great. That's great. I mean, I definitely think there is a history of computer games that are a lot of interesting history to them. There was a game called Civilization that was very popular.
Oh yes, I know about that.
Mm-hmm. So
SimCity, I love SimCity. Was another one that I actually got deeply involved in. Needless to say, Sid Meier's Civilization. We had a sponsor in my UCLA days in the mid '90s when that was just getting started. Who wanted to team us up with Sid Meier and thought that a 3D version of that, because at that time it was totally 2D, could make sense. And I think he may have actually gone off in that direction eventually.
Yeah, that's true. I think what's really fascinating is obviously the obvious nature that archaeology and computer graphics, by its very nature of simulating reality, plays a lot to do with each other. So getting into games makes sense to me. I also find it interesting that you were talking about how much films deviate from reality from those things because of artistic licenses that happen. And it's sort of, I feel it's a little bit of shame sometimes, obviously, but also, as you mentioned, it's,
and
notable.
I was just talking to a hedge fund that somehow has discovered us, invests in metaverses, and they wonder, what's your vision? So I said, well, okay, we're Flyover Zone, the virtual tourism company. So we're doing virtual tourism. But for us, that's just the low-hanging fruit because we recreate these places. And so then the easy thing is just to take people around and explain what we did and what they're seeing. That's virtual tourism. I love it. It's very important. But the real vision, again, going back to that 1986 paper that I gave at Apple, was the metaverse. It was, let me cut to 2007. We gave a press conference with the mayor of Rome when Rome Reborn 1.0 was finished. And it got a lot of coverage in the international media. And Second Life, Linden Labs contacted me the next day and said, we want you to put Rome Reborn into Second Life. So, you know, we studied that, and the basic problem, initial problem, was, well, what would go on? I mean, one thing, it wouldn't just be a ghost town. Something would have to go on. So I quickly came up with this idea that I called ancient life, which was, again, going back to the 1986 paper. What's ancient life? You come into ancient Rome as a freedman, as a recently freed slave, so you have very low status and hardly any money. And by learning a trade, you start accumulating wealth, obviously first at a modest scale, but you should learn to invest some of that wealth in your child. Everybody will be encouraged to get married and have at least one child, and you educate that child. Now, Rome was I used to say at UCLA when I started my Roman civilization classes, which I taught for many years to as many as 500 students, the Romans were the Americans of antiquity. Why? Multicultural society, meritocratic society, where people could rise from very humble origins to the very top. And a very open society, very tolerant society, with all kinds of religions and people of racial and religious background, all Roman citizens. Eventually, Roman citizenship was granted to all freeborn people within the confines of the Roman Empire, which went from the Scottish-English border all the way over to the Iraqi-Iranian border, so really big place. And therefore, the game of ancient life was start low and see how far you can rise. But the game ends after a certain limited period of time, like 3 months or 6 months. And then everybody is reincarnated as their child. So therefore, it's worth investing in the education of your child, who inherits whatever wealth you've accumulated, your dwelling and whatnot. And if the kid has had a good education, has been rubbing, you know, shoulders with other higher status people, and we can attest this in Rome, say the poet Horace was the son of an ex-slave in southern Italy, Venusia, and he was sent by his father to study in Rome. And who was he studying with? He was studying with people in the cultural elite, so then eventually becomes the court poet of the Emperor Augustus. So he went from nothing to the top. Right. So that's the way Rome was, and we want people to understand that. But the way you rise up is by role playing. So you learn how to be a cobbler, or you learn how to make clothes, and you get some money. And meanwhile, Rome Reborn is largely apartment buildings. Rome was, of the 7,000 known buildings, 6,800 were apartment buildings. And Rome Reborn, although since we use procedural city modeling, we could have built out the interior spaces. We didn't, because there's no need to. But one of the things could be, there's a lot of building out to be done. So as you earn money and you get your identity, you can build out your own apartment. And you can buy and sell apartments, you can buy and sell clothes. It's just like Second Life used to be. People right. became millionaires, right? Selling gear to other avatars yep. in Second Life. That could be done in Rome, but in a very historically accurate, you know, constrained way. And that would be an educational game, but it would be a game. And I think it would, again, if anyone's listening who wants to help us develop that, it would require a pretty serious investment. But this hedge fund seems to be considering doing that, actually, at the moment.
I think it's fascinating. I mean, you mentioned Second Life, obviously, was one of the first metaverses. And, you know, since then, I think, obviously, there's a lot of ideas of what a metaverse is and what it can do and where it serves. Do you feel, you know, you mentioned, you know, we're obviously talking about games because that's an easy way to explain metaverses. But do you think yes. that basically, you know, because of you've reconstructed Rome four times, as you said, it will continue, that it probably has a place to live in a form of a metaverse at some point where people have that ability to visit it. Tourism is one way to do it, but you were actually referring to a place to live in a sense, virtually yeah. live in some ways.
Yes. Well, that was the goal.
Right.
Actually, the goal was even crazier. It was, we're going to lock you into like a phone booth, call it a cave. Mm-hmm. We actually didn't have that term in 1986, but it came to be called the cave. Mm-hmm. That display with up to five walls, computer projection behind each wall, so you seem to be in this virtual world simulated on the walls everywhere you look around you. And you weren't going to be able to emerge until you became fluent in Latin, which I thought might take about 2 weeks. And even to get the food slipped under the door and the water to stay alive, you'd have to learn how to ask for it.
Wow. That's pretty crazy, but I like
yeah,
it.
But I've retreated from that extreme position. I think okay. even in the metaverse version I was sketching out there, I think it would be good. I think you'd be rewarded and should be rewarded if you could learn a few words of Latin, or if you're doing Athens, a few words of Greek. But yeah, we don't have to insist on fluency.
I think that there's people definitely like, you know, computer games, definitely people like challenges, and challenges are much harder than I think that, so I think that's a good idea. Starvation, I don't think is necessarily the correct motivation, but I think that's a really good idea. Well, I love, you know, what you're doing. I think it's really great. You mentioned, by the way, we've only passingly mentioned the Flyover Zone. So let's give us the big picture. Tell us a little bit more about Flyover Zone, what it is now, what you can do with it, and where you plan on taking it in the future.
Well, Flyover Zone is, first of all, pun. We're based in Bloomington, Indiana, which is in the heart of the famous Flyover Zone of the United States.
Yep.
But it's also refers to these virtual worlds, which even, you know, when I started creating them back in the 90s, when you presented it, it was called doing a fly through or a flyover. And so there's that pun going on. The mission of Flyover Zone is to recreate important cultural monuments and sites around the world. The more the merrier. We're starting with the obvious ones, Athens, Rome, Karnak, the Valley of the Kings, Pyramids of Giza. We did Baalbek in Lebanon, and now we're doing Tenochtitlan, the Aztec capital underneath Mexico City. We would love to do something in Asia, ideally, you know, something like the Forbidden City, but it's very hard to get access in China. Maybe we'll do something in Bali instead to stake our claim in that fourth corner of the world. And, you know, obviously in Mesoamerica, there's much more that we could do. We could do things in North America. Well, we can't do everything, and I'm sure others will come along to do other things. We seem to be the only ones doing it this way at the moment. And the key thing is always to involve the world's experts on whatever site it is that we're concentrating on. And if we can't get the experts, we don't do the site. And luckily there are, you know, and the world UNESCO World Heritage site list gives us our targets. It's about 1,100 sites right now. We've got that all in a database. So if we want to do site A and the expert on site A just says, forget it, I don't want to do this, which, by the way, nobody has ever said, but let's say they would say that, we would just go on to site B. There's plenty to do, and we're a small company. We can only do a couple a year. Right. So that's the vision, is to try to build this out. Why? To keep the love of cultural heritage alive among young people, first of all. Secondly, to create these resources that scholars can use, as for the reason we talked about, the empirical studies, to, by seeing new things, or seeing old things in a new way, to have new ideas, new insights that wouldn't be possible otherwise, most likely. And so, you know, we started with Rome. We then worked out in the Rome area, did Hadrian's Villa. We moved over to Athens, and at the same time, Egypt and Baalbek in Lebanon. Recently, we've put a team together for Mexico. And that's where we are now. We're about 10 full-time employees, another 15, 20 part-time collaborators in 8 countries on 3 continents.
That's a lot. That's great. And you, I mean, what kind of, obviously you mentioned, we talked about earlier how much harder it was to get resources to do things. Are you able to get more people to collaborate on this? Are you finding that young archaeology students are becoming very versed in computer graphics at the same time? Is this things that are these, are, is that, you know, been able to overcome some of those hurdles?
I think I wouldn't necessarily say that, although digital skills are spreading like wildfire through, you know, all branches of the arts and sciences. But we have the pros on our team who really can do that kind of work. What was most important for the young archaeologists, I would say, is just to be aware of what we're doing, not necessarily what we specifically are doing, but this kind of thing done by a lot of people now, and to support it, be interested in it, support it, want to get involved in it. And I remember in the old days, the hard, I would always say in UCLA in the mid-90s when I was trying to get support for what we were doing, the problem with getting support is I had to start with what's a computer, what's a file, what's a mouse. I mean, the background, the dependencies to get to what we specifically wanted to do were so many that by the time I got to what we wanted to do, everybody was asleep and totally bored or lost. Now, everybody gets that, and this we can cut right to the chase and explain what we're doing. And so that's really great. I find that easy to do among young people. And then, you know, I've been doing Rome Reborn for a long time. If you look at all the videos we posted through the years, we're somewhere between 3 and 4 million views. A lot of these kids will have seen the Rome Reborn videos, you know, in some class or other. It's, you know, there's even a Wikipedia article about it, and it's stated to be a successful project. I had nothing to do with it because you're not allowed to do your own Wikipedia articles, as you may know. But right. I was happy to see that they declared it a success and a kind of a classic digital humanities project. So I think it's generally well known. So that means that the kids coming along now who are in their 20s know about it. At least they've heard about it. And so it's not that hard to get them involved. It hasn't been hard at all. We've been able to, as I say, nobody's ever said no when we've asked them to collaborate. Yeah. Of any age, even the old people who don't know anything about the technology. The people who, the most conservative scholars, the ones who do survey, who are just the facts and, you know, survey the monuments, they love what we're doing because we love what they're doing. We use what they're doing. They're the kind of experts we absolutely must have because right from the beginning, I saw there were, you know, free programs like, say, SketchUp, which I'm not sure existed in 1995 when we started. But I think there were things like that were free where any 10-year-old could make the Roman Forum. But, you know, what value did it have? The people we got to do the Roman Forum were the cultural authorities administering the Roman Forum and the people who've written the monographs about this or that feature of the Roman Forum. Those are the views that you want to concretize in 3D and visualize and that have some value, I think. People.
Absolutely. I think that's yeah, absolutely. I think it's wonderful that you've, you know, obviously you're studying a hardcore in the past and you're using the latest technology of the future to do it, you know. So I think it's kind of a wonderful marriage of these two worlds really to try to do that and to communicate that to a lot of people in the way you have done. I mean, I was reading your bio and I was reading all the stuff about you before I did. And so I was like, wait a minute, I know all of that past of when that happened in the 90s and where we're like, what can we do with this technology and just starting to figure it out. It was a very important time.
I remember back then they were saying in like 1990, 95, it was common to say virtual reality is a solution in search of a problem.
Yep.
That was said many, many times. There was a cliche about it. You know, very nice, but what are you going to do with it? But right from the beginning, I said, I know what the problem is. The problem is I've got 500 students in a class at UCLA. I'm trying to teach them ancient Rome. I already told you the field was totally disorganized and complicated by the fact that all those disparate studies were in different languages, which the students didn't know. Let's clean this thing up and make it simple and approachable through a visualization. Virtual reality visualization, which was interactive, where you could move around and maybe even talk to an avatar who would explain something to you. That I saw immediately.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
I definitely think, I think that's great. And I think that, you know, the original vision you had in the early 90s, you're still getting closer and closer and closer to what that you're trying to achieve in that area, which is also nice.
Finally, 86, really. And you know, you can document it. You could read on academia.edu. You can download my Project Cicero paper published in 1988. By the way, the people who attended that conference were Doug Engelbart, who invented the mouse, and Alan Kay, who invented the user graphical interface, who Apple assigned to me to help with Rome Reborn back in the 80s, and because he lived in Brentwood, California, right across the street from UCLA virtually. So I'm sure you heard of Alan Kay, it was a very small conference, but for me, it had really big consequences.
That's awesome.
The other point I wanted to make, though, about the modern technology and the ancient studies is actually this is not a new thing. It's not a new thing. Think about photography. Okay, you've got the daguerreotype, but the photography descends from the calotype. Well, the calotype was invented by an archaeologist, an English archaeologist, Fox Talbot.
Right. Right.
And, you know, for use in archaeology. Or the stereo photography. You have the Holmes stereopticon. Well, Oliver Wendell Holmes, not the jurist, but his father, who's a professor of medicine at Harvard, in about 1850, proposed panoramic photography to document the monuments. And he said, well, once you did that, you didn't need the monuments anymore. You could throw them away or destroy them. They wouldn't serve any purpose. You'd have them all reduced to panos. And that became a very successful company. Every middle-class family in America had a stereopticon in their living room by the year 1900. Not necessarily made by the Holmes company, but by all the others who were competing against Holmes. So,
LiDAR scanners,
I believe there's a natural relationship between new tech and archaeology, actually, because these monuments have a perennial appeal. And so, you know, entrepreneurs come along and say, we can tap into that already existing desire of people to go there to understand these things by applying the new technical solution to making it easier and better, quicker, cheaper to do that. Yeah. And actually, like our company, you could say what in our business plan, I start by talking about what is the company basically about? It's about the same thing the internet's about, disintermediation. But what are we disintermediating? We're disintermediating a certain kind of travel. Well, other kinds of travel have been disintermediated. We have telecommuting, we have telemedicine, and now we have what you could call teletourism, except that that word, which we wanted to use, is being trademarked by a company, doesn't seem to be doing anything with it, so we have to settle for virtual tourism, which isn't quite as good, I think. But the teletourism market, in our sense, is very big, potentially. The thing that we're trying to disintermediate is the cultural tourism industry, real-world tourism industry, which, according to the United Nations World Tourism Organization in 2019, was worth about $775 billion. And we don't want to replace it. We want to enhance it. We want to help if we're successful, more people will go to Baalbek, because a lot of people never heard of Baalbek. But by using our virtual tour, which is free, by the way, it'll suddenly be on their mental map, and some of them anyway will want to go there. That's what we hope will happen. When they're there, if they have it on their cell phone, they can use it as an AR app to do their own self-guided tour. And when they come home, they can deepen their understanding of what they've seen, keep the memory alive. So we think that virtual tourism and real world tourism can work hand in glove, but that's what we're sort of disintermediating. Just the need to get on a plane and make that trip and spend all that money. On top of which we're showing you not only the ruins, which we do, but the way we're bringing the ruins back to life, which even going there is not going to do for you.
Right. Right. Well, that's fascinating. I think it's wonderful what you're doing, and appreciate it. We're just over an hour, which is usually about the length of our podcast, and I really appreciate your time. Fascinating stuff. I've always been, you know, like I said, I've always had an interest in it. I think it's because I was around a bunch of Egyptologists as a child, so maybe that's a part of what it was. But I really think this is a wonderful thing, and obviously your work you've done is fascinating. I can't wait to see what happens next. I'll be pushing for the Rome video game, because I think that would be a really great thing to have as well. So thank you so much, Bernie, for doing this.
Thank you, Chris, for inviting me. I greatly enjoyed talking to you. I'm looking forward to many more conversations with you, online or offline.
It sounds great.